CSN International presents To Every Man an Answer, the live apologetics program that equips you to give a reason for the hope that lies within you.
If you have a Bible question or a question on the Christian faith, you can call us at 1-888-827-5276. Again, that's 1-888-ASK-CSN.
Let's get things started. Here's today's host, Mike Kessler.
Hi, and welcome to Tuesday's edition of To Every Man an Answer. Glad you've joined us as we get together every weekday afternoon at this time, answering questions about the Bible from the Bible, looking at a world from a Christian viewpoint, how important that is, and also what we hear in church. Is it even in the Bible at all? If you've got a question you'd like to ask us, that number to call again, 888-ASK-CSN. If you've been sharing your faith, someone's asked you a question, you want to give them a good answer, come across something in the Bible you don't understand, that's why we're here for you each and every weekday afternoon, live radio. And so again, 888-ASK-CSN. Joining me today, special guest and featured CSN speaker, comes on 1 hour before To Every Man an Answer. We have from Calvary Chapel OC, John Randall. Hi, and welcome, John.
Hey, Mike, great to be with you here from Calvary South OC down here in San Clemente. And boy, it's just looking forward to a great program today.
Yeah, always fun answering questions with you. Looking for you to help answer so many questions. And again, I think it's such a great time to just right now, as we just look at everything going on in the world, to just be able to get together in the afternoons and talk about real things, real radio, and I think it's always a blessing to do that. And so how are things there at Calvary Chapel OC?
Well, thanks so much for asking. You know, Mike, last time I was on about a week ago, I had shared with you that we were getting ready to go down to Beverly Hills on Saturday, and there was a clinic called the DuPont Clinic that was about to open there in Beverly Hills that was an all-trimester abortion clinic. Well, I've got some great news. We went down there for a time of worship and prayer. Myself and a few others took the platform, standing for the preborn. And Mike, they got a letter from the mayor and from the city council that they are not going to open that facility. It got shut down. Praise God.
Wow, in California.
If God can shut something down in California,
I'll tell you, he can do that anywhere. So
it was a miracle. It was so exciting to have a, you know, sometimes you don't really get a victory. You know, you go up to Sacramento, you go up here, you do what you can, you know, you got to do something. But what was so exciting is to actually have that announcement made from the platform that day while we were there. The streets filled with hundreds of people that were gathered erupted in joy and praise and celebration. So I just want to testify to the faithfulness of God.
How wonderful, more lives saved. And that's what that directly means. Again, abortion is not, you know, ridding a human body of unwanted tissue. It's a real human being with a real beating heart. It's a real baby. And unfortunately for the Democratic Party, they don't seem to understand that babies are precious. And so we have to always do our best to speak for those who can't. And so blessings. That's a real good news, John, and being about your daddy's business. Well, let's go ahead and go to the phones. Again, 888-ASK-CSN's the number to call. We got some lines open. We have Joel on the line, Las Cruces, New Mexico. Hi, welcome.
I had a comment about a disturbing experience that I had yesterday. Here at the where I live, there's a person that comes here and helps me to clean and with the making the food and stuff. Like, they call them caregivers. And I've been watching this lady for a while, and she has a lot of new age stuff thinking, you know, mystical way of thinking of things, you know, like negative energy, positive energy. And yesterday I remembered what you said on the radio before, that if a person can't say the words Jesus is Lord, that there's something wrong with that person, you know. There's something definitely not right. And I asked her point blank, you know, can you say Jesus is Lord, you know? I've never heard you say it. and you talk about being Christian and all that. And she couldn't say it, and she was very mad at me. She got violent, and it was just a disturbing experience, you know. And I wanted to call for yesterday. I called yesterday for prayer, but the time ran out. Maybe you can do it today.
Sure. Wow, that's it's real, you know, Joel. I mean, a lot of people think demon possession is made up or some, you know, kind of Hollywood kind of idea. Demon possession is absolutely real. America has been very blessed because of our Judeo-Christian heritage. But as America rapidly moves away from that heritage, I believe we're seeing more and more brought in through mysticism, brought in through alcohol and drugs, brought in through just the flat out the occult, Ouija boards, brought out through fortune telling and necromancy. All those things, I believe, break down the normal resistance that God has given human beings against the forces of the underworld. But when we tamper with that, the demons can then move into a person. And we find through the Gospels and the New Testament, people possessed by devils doing very, very strange, unusual things. And so I really believe that, again, with this person that you know, this woman, you know, being that she's gotten involved in, it sounds like a bit of the occult through crystals and the New Age movement, may very well be that she has picked up a demon somewhere along the lines. Now, not all demons are shrieking demoniacs like we find in Gadara when Jesus crossed over the Sea of Galilee and a man met him who would cut himself and live in the tombs and things like this. Some are familiar spirits, like the woman that met Paul, saying, "These are the men of the Most High God that show the way to salvation. Listen to them." Sounds legit, but it isn't. And the Bible says that it took Paul evidently a couple days to figure out that this woman was demon possessed. I don't think all the time they're easily to be detected. Paul certainly would have cast that demon out immediately had he known what the problem was. But it says he became greatly annoyed by this woman's chattering. And when they cast the demon out of her, she could no longer tell fortunes. So understanding, that's in Acts 16, understanding that demons are real. Yeah, we'll pray for you, Joel, that God would give you his discerning, that gift of discerning of spirits, so you'd be able to ascertain what the real problem is here and help this woman in some way. John, your thoughts?
Well, I wanted to say, Joel, that the Bible does tell us to be strong in the Lord and the power of his might, tells us to put on the whole armor of God that we may be able to withstand against the wiles of the devil. And then Paul says the reason for this is because we're not wrestling against flesh and blood, but we're actually wrestling against principalities and powers, against rulers of darkness of this age, and against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. And so we have to make sure that engage in the spiritual battle, that we are wearing the proper armament that God has provided. And then one other thing to remember, Joel, as we pray for you today, is the Bible tells us in 1 John 4:4 that you are of God, little children, and you have overcome them because he who is in you is greater than he who is in this world. Don't forget that there is greater power. The name of Jesus, every demonic spirit, the devil himself can't stand against the name of Jesus. And we have power in his name and we're clothed in his armor.
So I hope that helps.
Yes, sir. Just keep me in prayer.
Yeah, let's pray for you right now. Father, we come to you in Jesus' name. Thank you for Joel's heart that loves you and wants to see this woman delivered. We just ask you, God, that you would give him a wise and a discerning heart to know what is going on. Father, that you would give him boldness. You'd bind the evil spirits that are perhaps in this woman, that they could be removed if this is indeed what the issue is. And so, Lord, we just ask you for that supernatural anointing upon Joel so he would be able to do what you have called him to do, what you've called us all to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Joel, our prayers are with you. If you need us, we're here for you. Stay in line. We'll send you out a couple of books, a couple of DVDs. The movie Jesus, I think, is also a neat blessing, great for evangelism. You stay in line. We'll get those out to you, okay?
Thank you. Thank you.
Joel, we're here for you if you need us. Let's go to Joseph, Las Vegas, Nevada. Hi, welcome.
Hi, Mike. Hi, John.
Hi.
I have a question on the book of Luke, and it's chapter 9, verses 58 through 61, I guess it is. It says that, and Jesus said unto them, foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath not where to lay his head. And he said to another one, just follow me. But he said, Lord, suffer me first to go and bury my father. And Jesus said unto him, let the dead bury their dead, but go thou and preach the kingdom of God. That is my main one, that the dead preach, or the dead burying the dead. And if you look at the next verse after that, it says, then another also said to Lord, I will follow thee, but let me first go bid them farewell, which are at home at my house. And Jesus said unto him, no man having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. I need some clarification on this. Those sound like sort of very rude replies for somebody who said he would want to follow Jesus.
Well, understanding the Hebrew culture, which is really important, this remark that you mentioned earlier, then he said to another, follow me, and he said, Lord, let me first go bury my father. That wasn't that his dad was dead and just any minute they were going to put him in the grave. Let me go stay with my father till he dies. Then I will come and follow you. That's what it means. Let me bury my dad. Let me let his life live out so I can go. Then I'll come and follow you then. And this is what Jesus was saying. Let the dead bury the dead. Look, there's always an excuse not to do what God wants. And the second verse, likened to it, let me go bid farewell to my family. Well, that could take anywhere from a couple of days to, who knows, 6 months. Those families were very large back then. It wasn't that you just went home or got somebody on the cell phone and said, hey, mom, pop, hey, I'm going to follow Jesus. No, it was usually a big send-off that we find, and it took some consideration and thought. Even if you remember going back to the prodigal son, when he said, I'm going to go live my life the way I want. Dad, give me my half the farm. In saying farewell, there was also a distribution of the family inheritance oftentimes. So both of these were not just going, I'm going to bury my dad, I'll be back tomorrow. That's not what Jesus is saying here. It's that, first of all, the guy wanted to stay with his father till he died. The second one was, and Jesus, knowing all things, this guy could have had a very large family in which it may have taken months for this farewell to officially take place. Your thoughts, John?
You know, here in this section of scripture, in the context, Jesus is describing really what it means to be a disciple. There were many people that followed Jesus because they wanted to see a miracle. Others followed him because at times he would provide free food. There were different motives for following Jesus. And here we find that Jesus is being very clear with those that said, I'll do whatever you want. And then Jesus says, well, this is what's required. And then the response is, well, I've got something else to do. And I think, Mike, there's people like that even today, people that say, I'll follow you, Lord.
There's
I want to do my own thing, or I want to come to you on my terms as opposed to yours. Or, you know what, Lord, I want to follow you, but I still want to live a sinful life. No. You come to Jesus on his terms. You got to count the cost. And so he's being very clear and upfront so that nobody has a misunderstanding of what they're getting themselves into. And you'll find as you go on in this narrative, Joseph, in the Gospels, that as you get towards the end, you're going to find that there are going to be many that are no longer going to follow him. In fact, Jesus will say to his disciples after some difficult statements, he said, are you also going to go away? And Peter responds, Lord, where else are we going to go? You alone have the words of eternal life. And so Jesus is whittling down. I mean, he's weeding out those would-be disciples from those that were sincerely and genuinely wanting to follow him.
Amen. I hope that answers it for you.
Okay. Well, listen, when on that verse 62, then Jesus said unto him, no man having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. What do you suppose? Is that just saying that he's a farmer? He should keep on farming or what?
No, he's saying here very clearly, no one having put his hand to the plow. In other words, you're going to go do something for the kingdom of heaven. But as Lot's wife was, God said, get out of Sodom and Gomorrah. Don't look back. And she looked back. Why? Her heart was still there. If you look back, you'll never plow a straight line. If you look backwards, you'll never drive down the road straight. And the problem is we have a lot of people with one foot in Jesus and another foot in the world. And the problem is, in order to do that, you have to have a compromised message. The Bible says today is the appointed day of salvation. Not later, not tomorrow, not yesterday, but it's today. Today is the appointed day of salvation. So this is where we have to go. I've had people come up to me and say, well, Mike, soon as I get married, you know, I'm going to get into ministry. I've also had one guy one time say, Mike, soon as I get a divorce, I'm going to get into ministry. There's always some kind of an excuse that we will offer as we begin our quest to serve God. And then there'll be some reason why we have to turn back. And I believe this is why you just have to count it loss and go on. This is why, again, in the Bible, we find make your calling and your election sure. John, any last thoughts?
Yeah, I would just say what he's doing there, Joseph, is he's giving the people in that agrarian society, that farming community. Let me give you an example of what I mean. So the reference to a man plowing in a field and not looking back, and everybody in that society would understand, oh, I understand what you mean by that. They had seen that before. He's applying that as an illustration to what it means to be his disciple and to follow him. In the same way that a man plows a field and he looks ahead without looking back, it's the same thing for a disciple who's going to follow Jesus without making an excuse or going back to the old life. So it was basically an illustration of what it meant to be a disciple. And everybody there would have been able to track with what Jesus was saying.
I hope that helps.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense now. Thank you very much.
Well, God bless you. And I'm glad you're reading your Bible, Joseph. And if you come across anything else like that, but a little bit of it, we have to understand that Jesus was not calloused towards people's individual needs. And it would appear that way in just a light reading of this, not really understanding what is being said here. But in those days, again, you didn't just go home, hey, everybody, I'm going to go serve Jesus, see you later. And no, Jesus said, you can't even do that. No, that's not what it's about. It's these ideas of when you bid your family goodbye, there was involved in that, again, the dividing of inheritance, contacting your family, your relatives, could take weeks, months to do that. And again, Jesus, when I really, as an example, just to give you a parallel to this, when Jesus approached Matthew Levi, he said, follow me. And Matthew Levi dropped everything. Now, he had a very high-ranking government cushy job, being a tax collector, dropped it all and followed Jesus immediately. He didn't say, well, you know, let me cash out my 401k first. You know, Jesus, I got to tell you, I've got 2 weeks vacation pay coming. I've been, you know, kind of checking out this little port on the Sea of Galilee. You know, I'm thinking about maybe, you know, going up there and doing some swimming. No, he just dropped everything and followed him. So this is the idea here that we get, that make your calling and your election sure. And when Jesus calls, I want to listen. I don't want to wait a week or month or a year before I respond to what God says. I want to do it. I want to do it now. So, Joseph, hope that helps. Stay in line. We'll get you fixed up with those DVDs, books, movie Jesus. Share them with your friends. Let's go to William, Washington. Hi, welcome.
Hey, I'm praying for you guys.
Thank you.
My question is about end time. So it's to my understanding that the battle, and I could be wrong about all this, but the battle of Revelation likely starts around the middle of the 7 years and then is ended by the second coming of our Lord and Savior. Now, is there a battle that starts or preludes the 7 years? And if so, what battle is it? And what is the battle of Ezekiel 38?
Wow, you got a lot of things going on there. First, the battle of Ezekiel 38, 39. Is, I believe, before the tribulation. Now, how far before, I don't know. But we do know Ezekiel 39 says they burned their weapons for 7 years. So I do not believe the Jewish people will be burning weapons into the millennial reign of Christ. The tribulation period is only 7 years long as well. And so let's say the Ezekiel 38, 39 war was in the second year of the tribulation, that means that while Jesus is ruling and reigning from Jerusalem, you're going to have all this black smoke from all these weapons that they've been burning. I don't see that at all. I believe that when Jesus comes back, he's going to make all things new. He's going to restore a very, very corrupted, destroyed ecologically planet. He's going to do all these things that he's going to make new again. They won't be burning weapons in the millennial reign of Christ. So I know that has to come before. And it may very well be that this is, again, part of the catalyst that causes Russia with their running out of money right now, the whole Ukraine problem, to come down against Israel rather soon. And we know that the Antichrist then, in Revelation chapter 6, a guy on a white horse going out conquering and to conquer. He has a bow with no arrows, which tells me initially he's going to go out to unite the world diplomatically. But when that is exhausted and there are pockets of resistance, as the Bible says there will be, then he goes after them militarily. The red fiery horse goes out, the war horse. Then we find, of course, the pale horse, the black horse, death and famine, the pestilences that come. One quarter of the world's population dies in the first, very first part of the seven-year tribulation period. Now, this is pretty stark when you stop to think that they just announced there's 8 billion people on Earth. That means 2 billion people will die in relatively a short amount of time once the Antichrist comes to power. So the idea of the dawning of the age of Aquarius, that no heaven above us, no hell below us, above us only sky, and the world will be as one, is the biggest lie that's ever been perpetrated. It's going to be hell on earth. Yes, it's going to come under a one world order, but there's going to be a lot of problems in doing that. Now, the Battle of Armageddon is at the end of the seven-year reign of the Antichrist, the seven-year tribulation period. And what stops the tribulation, this tribulation, as well as the Battle of Armageddon, is Jesus himself. He comes back and wages war. They're all fighting each other, but when they see Jesus, they turn to fight him, and this is where he lays waste. While, believe it or not, his bride, mounted on horses, watches all of it. The Bible never says we will be participating in the Battle of Armageddon with Jesus, and as supernatural enforcers, you might say. I think this is just something Jesus does to impress his bride, if you will. Your thoughts?
Well, I would just add to that, you know, William, that as it relates to, I think what's going to usher in the tribulation and what's going to start it is the removal of the church in what is called the rapture, where we're caught up to be with the Lord. Paul writes about it in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. The trumpet's going to sound, dead in Christ is going to rise first. We who are alive and remain will be caught up to be with the Lord. And when that happens, when the church is taken, I believe that just gives way. When that which is restraining evil is removed, that is the Holy Spirit working through the church, is taken out of this wicked world, then you're going to see a Christ-rejecting world being judged as the tribulation period begins. And then 3.5 years into the tribulation period, there's going to be a rebuilt temple. There's going to be a treaty with Israel. The Antichrist is then going to set himself up to be God, demand to be worshiped as God. And then he's going to turn all his guns and all his ammunition against the Jewish people. And they're going to realize that they need their Messiah. And people are going to be even getting saved during that time. At the end of that 3.5 years, the Battle of Armageddon, that final 3.5 year period, the Battle of Armageddon follows. As Mike mentioned, Jesus comes back. And the Bible says a sharp sword proceeds out of his mouth, and with it, he strikes the nations. I mean, it's game over. And then he establishes his kingdom, and we get into the millennial reign, get into eternity. It's going to be an exciting future, Mike.
Amen. Hope that helps.
Yes. And so then is the valley, the Har Megiddo Valley, is that just the staging area, or is that where they're slaughtered?
That's where the battle will be. And I believe it was Patton, military general of the United States, said it's probably one of the best arrayed battlefields that he's ever seen. And this huge battle will take place. William, we'll pick more of this up on the other side of the break. We don't want you to go away. We'll have more right after this.
Thank you for listening to CSN Radio, where God's word is heard. Did you know your financial support is a primary reason we can broadcast over 400 stations nationwide? It's true. We are grateful for your partnership. As you know, our nation is battling over religious and civil freedoms. Here at CSN Radio, our listeners can trust us to be a solid biblical teaching foundation and share a Christian perspective on current times. The importance of reaching the masses is greater than ever. We need your support in this uncertain time of chaos and strife. We are excited to share that we plan to add more stations in 2023 and 2024. This means we will reach more of the lost, broken, and deceived. Mark 16 verse 15 quotes Jesus. He said to them, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation." We need your support in funding the building of these new stations. You can go to csnradio.com/donate or call 1-800-357-4226. That's csnradio.com/donate or call us at 1-800-357-4226.
You're dialed in to the Christian Satellite Network. We're broadcasting on hundreds of stations nationwide, including multiple stations in North and South Carolina. You can listen while in Charleston, Myrtle Beach, Eden, the Winston-Salem area, and many more great cities throughout North and South Carolina. To find your closest station, log online to csnradio.com, and you can listen live 24/7 worldwide. CSN International, where God's word is heard.
Back to part two of To Every Man an Answer with John Randall, Pastor Calvary Chapel, South OC, San Clemente, California. I'm your host, Mike Kessler, in Twin Falls, Idaho. On the line, we have with us William asking questions about this time on earth so dreadful. Jesus said in Matthew 24, unless those days were shortened, there'd be no flesh saved. It is interesting that the book of Revelation is written all about this particular time. In fact, it's such a dreadful time that God gave those believing saints during that particular time their own book to help them navigate through the worst time in the history of this world. Now, you look back in history, there's been a lot of pretty bad things. The Dark Ages, the Roman Inquisitions, all these different things that have gone down through the history of ages. Yet the Bible says, no, the world's worst days are yet to come. And so when I see this, I understand the threat of global nuclear war with nations that are the 30th poorest country on earth, North Korea, possessing nuclear weapons. When you look at Iran developing their nuclear weapons, not to mention whatever has been sold on the black market from the Soviet Union, the suitcase atomic bombs and all, when you realize just exactly what we're up against in these days, it is no wonder the Bible says almost two-thirds of the world's population dies in this seven-year period of time. It is, again, not the dawning of the age of Aquarius, and the world will be as one. You will never have global peace without the Prince of Peace. And so I believe this is why it is so important that we understand how important you are. We as Christians, the light of the world, the salt of the earth, to let your light shine. Jesus said, work for the night is coming when no one can work. Because again, either we won't be here or the people we want to reach may not be here. So again, William, I hope that answers it for you. Is there any other part of the question that we didn't answer?
So to kind of recap, so Gog, being Russia, moves down on Israel, and this starts where this could potentially open up the entryway for the Antichrist to come to power. But then Israel will burn those weapons for 7 years that are left over from that war.
Yes.
And then at the end of the 7 years, the armies of the world will gather together in the Valley of Megiddo to destroy God. And then that is when they will be slaughtered.
You are. Well, real quick. Now, something to remember. The rapture of the church, it doesn't ever say this in the Bible, starts the tribulation period. It doesn't say that. And I don't think it'd be long. I mean, maybe a year, maybe 2 years or something. I don't know. I don't think it'll be long. But it may very well be that the church is gone before the Ezekiel 38-39 war transpires. And then that, in turn, will set the stage for the Antichrist. Now, remember, the Bible tells us that Russia, accompanied with the Muslim states, Ethiopia, Libya, the countries around the Balkan Sea, Iran, which is Iraq, Afghanistan, that's Persia, that's mentioned there in Ezekiel 38, Turkey is also mentioned. These powerful Arab countries will come against Israel. No one comes to Israel's defense, not the United States, which right now would not be a big surprise to me. So when they come against Israel, the Bible says God's fury arises in his face and he destroys 5/6 of the invading army. Imagine the humiliation of the Arab states believing that Allah would deliver Israel into their hands. There's a little bitty country, size of New Jersey about. And it takes on actually almost World War III, and God fights for Israel, destroys 5/6 of the invading army. I think the humiliation of the Muslim world will be staggering at that point. And with the church gone, the Antichrist comes on the world scene, this man of peace, in some way I believe will offer some kind of consolation for the Muslim world. Again, he's going to create a Chrislam, a unification of all the religions, where, as we see the bumper stickers, coexist. Well, it's going to be something like that. And here, many people believe what actually starts the tribulation period is actually, the Bible says, a treaty that is signed with Israel. And most people believe, because so much was surrounding the temple in the Old Testament, it may very well be that he signs a treaty with Israel, with the Arab world. And this could be after this Ezekiel 38 war to allow them to rebuild their third temple that we find John measuring in chapter 11 of Revelation. Now, the Bible says the outer court has been given to the Gentiles. And so we know that the outer court was really as far as non-believers, non-Jewish people could even come to the into towards the temple anyway. So the north and the east of the Temple Mount there in Jerusalem, Israel, there's about 11 to 15 acres of nothing but trees and sidewalks that I believe the Antichrist will negotiate a peace treaty with the Arab world so they can build their temple, thereby the Jews, befriending the Jews, offering some kind of consolation to the Muslim world and the so-called Christians that are left behind, which will be probably modernist without Christ, having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof, using the name Christian but really aren't. There on the Temple Mount, all three world religions can worship together. And this man of peace, the Antichrist, negotiates this. The world will say, who is able to make war with the Antichrist? Now, they're not going to be calling him that. This man of peace, they're going to call him. But he, for the first 3.5 years, uses this coexist, this chrislam, if you will, to unite the world. But then the abomination which makes desolate, the Bible tells us clearly 3.5 years into the tribulation period, this is where the Antichrist puts a picture of himself, he himself, or his name in the temple in Jerusalem and declares to the world that he is God and must now be worshiped as God. I believe that because I think the Jews will recognize this world Messiah as a friend, but they're not going to recognize him as God. I believe the Antichrist knows that. I believe that the demonic forces driving the Antichrist will also know this. And so Jesus said, don't even go back into your house to get your coat. Just run for the hills. Up to just a few years ago, with the high-speed missiles that they now have, 150 years ago, this would have never been an issue. But Jesus said, you've got to run and run fast because I believe the missiles will be flying. The Antichrist is not going to suffer global humiliation because the nation of Israel, who he befriended in helping them build their temple, now turn their back on him and won't worship him as God. He's going to bring swift retaliation to save face with the world. And I believe this is why Jesus said, run for the hills. Quickly, don't even go back in your house to get a coat. Just go. Wow, when you stop to think about that, that's pretty intensive. So understanding that, we have then the Antichrist, and it may very well be. He gives the permission. They're doing their sacrifices. The grand dedication, they're 3.5 years, probably somewhere about 3.5 years after he gives them permission. It may be the grand dedication, and the guest of honor may very well be the Antichrist. And he shows up or has his picture or his image in the temple. And this is where he makes his declaration. The very religious system he made, he scraps and says, now I'm the reason for religion. You worship me. And Jesus said, the world enters its final countdown. Hope that helps.
Very helpful. Thank you.
William, God bless you. Stay in line. We'll send you out some books, some DVDs. I got 101 Last Days Prophecies I'm going to send you. I think you'll really like that. So stay in line. We'll get you taken care of. Let's go to Felipe, Texas. Hi, welcome. Felipe, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Hi, how may
God
we
bless
help?
Y'all.
Yes.
Yes, I have God bless you first, both of y'all. I'm grateful to God for what you guys do. May God empower you to continue using your ministry. And my question to you guys is, I came across a video where I strongly believe Jesus is God in flesh. But, you know, there's a question that was asked. If Jesus is God, then he knows everything. But then when the disciple asked him when it was coming, it was, I don't recall the scripture, but when they were asked the time and the hour, it's the scripture says that no one knows the time and the hour, nor the Son. And usually in this video, the Muslim asked, if God, Jesus was God, why didn't he know the hour, you know?
Right. So, great. That's a great question, Felipe. John.
You know, in Matthew 24, verse 36, is the passage of scripture I believe you're referring to, Felipe, where it reads this way, but of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. And so the question is, if Jesus is God, then how was it that he would say he did not know the hour? Well, the way to understand that is you have to begin to delve into what is called the incarnation. The Bible tells us that when Jesus came, he was fully God, and yet at the same time, he was fully man. It's called the incarnation. John tells us in John chapter 1, the Word, Jesus, became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. The glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. If you cross-reference over to the book of Philippians in chapter 2, the Apostle Paul has what is called there the self-emptying of Christ. It's Philippians chapter 2, verses 6 and 8, and he talks about how that when Jesus came into the world, that he laid aside his divine privileges and he took on the form of humanity. Oh, he's still God, and yet he humbled himself and became a man. He allowed his divine privileges to be set aside. And so in his humanity at that moment, in taking that humble position, that's why he said what he said. Now, granted, Jesus obviously knows the day he's coming back now. But in that moment, as he was sharing with his disciples about this second coming and when the exact day was, he's saying nobody knows. No, not even himself at that moment. In his incarnation, in his humanity, he gave up those divine privileges. He veiled his glory, and he chose to occupy the position of a servant at that moment. So it's not denying the deity of Jesus, because over and over and over throughout the scriptures in the gospels, Jesus emphasized his deity. He said, before Abraham was, I am. He said, if you've seen the Father, you've seen me. And so that's why they picked up stones to stone him. That's why they crucified him, because they said, you being a man, make yourself equal with God. Jesus never denied that. But in his position as a servant, self-emptying of those divine privileges, that's why he said what he said in Matthew chapter 24 in verse 36.
Amen. I hope that helps.
That did help, and it really helped me, because I had an answer for that. I wasn't sure the scripture, but you confirmed it. Philippians chapter 2, where I was leaning on, where it says that he emptied himself. And I feel that that's the scripture that would be a good scripture to follow for those that are questioning and kind of like, but I was leaning on that on Philippians chapter 2, and you just did confirm, and I appreciate your help.
Yeah, Felipe, and there's more to it than just that. If, again, Jesus giving up that part of his deity, do you really think if Jesus hadn't done that, they could nail God to a cross? I mean, if he had his full power, he could have called 10,000 angels. He didn't. See, the thing is, yes, he was fully God and fully man. But that fully man part is what I believe oftentimes would allow Jesus to be crucified, would allow Jesus not to know the time of the rapture. I believe that is why we see that element. But Jesus, again, fully God, and just as you mentioned, John, where Jesus said, before Abraham was, I am, claiming to be God of the Old Testament that spoke to Moses in the burning bush. And John 8:59, it says, and they picked up stones to stone him. Why? He was claiming to be God. So, hope that helps.
That did help. I appreciate y'all. Thank y'all. Blessings to both of y'all.
Stay on the line, Felipe. We'll fix you up with some books, DVDs. With that, we'll go to Randy, Golden Valley, Arizona. Hi, welcome.
Hi, can you hear me okay?
Yes, we can.
Oh, great. God bless you guys. You know that previous caller about three calls, four calls back, you're talking about, you know, the fall of Jesus. I got a good scripture, first of all, yeah, that I memorized. It's 2 Timothy chapter 2:19. I hope he's listening. Nevertheless, the solid foundation of God stands, having this seal. The Lord knows those who are his. And let everyone who names the name of Christ depart from iniquity.
Amen.
And that That is a good scripture, because that everyone who names the name of Christ, a lot of Christians out there are naming the name of Christ, but they want to go both ways. They may be having some problems with some secret sins, and that is a very good scripture.
Amen.
And my question is, Pastor Mike, you know, the thousand-year millennium, is that going to be like a real, like, 1,000 years in mortal time on the earth?
Absolutely. No doubt about it. So, and it is interesting to me that recorded history, man has about been on this earth for about 6,000 years. And it is interesting that you have 1,000 years there, and all the way through the Bible, it tells us about the fallen, sinful nature of man. Now, people have often said, well, the reason people are bad is because they have had bad influences in their life. They've had negative input. And believe it or not, as nutty as Charlie Manson was, this is what he was proclaiming. And so his idea is that he was going to take these children, take them out to the desert, never let them hear the word no, never let them hear anything negative. Then by killing Sharon Tate and family, it would create a race war that the whites and the blacks would destroy each other. And then out of the desert, Charlie Manson would come with this new chosen group of people, these kids that have never heard no, and they would no longer have any desire to kill anybody or anything like that. Now, as nutty as it was at the time when he said that, has now been adapted by most of the colleges in America for normal thinking. But that is not true. The Bible says we have inherited an old sin nature from Adam. And it's interesting, in living for 1,000 years in a perfect environment, humankind, a perfect environment, perfect food, perfect ecosystem, perfect climate, perfect everything, perfect government. At the end, when Satan is loosed, as sand is on the seashore, they rebel against the very Lord that gave them all these wonderful things to prove the old sin nature is exactly what God says. It's been corrupted ever since Adam. Your thoughts, John?
You know, the purpose of them, we do believe, Randy, I really do appreciate the question, that there is a literal 1,000 years. Yes. Several things take place during that literal 1,000 years. One, Satan is going to be bound for 1,000 years. And as Mike said, there's so many promises and prophecies that are going to be fulfilled during that 1,000-year reign. There's many covenants and promises that God made to the nation, and several things that are going to take place that will be fulfilled during that 1,000-year reign. I think of what Isaiah said. You remember in Isaiah chapter 11, he says, the wolf is going to dwell with the lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with the young goat, and the calf with the lion, and the fatted calf together, and the little child shall lead them. I mean, it's just this whole completely different environment in relation to the world, in relation to the animal kingdom. And the Lord's going to rule and reign, the Bible says, with a rod of iron. All the nations are going to come and bow before the Lord as he rules from the throne of David. So many promises and prophecies will be fulfilled during that literal 1,000-year reign. The other thing that's interesting, Mike, and this is where sometimes people ask perhaps a follow-up question, what Randy is saying, well, what are we going to be doing during the millennial reign? We're going to glorify bodies? What are we going to be up to? Well, the Bible says we're going to rule and reign. Well, what does that mean? We're going to rule and reign. I mean, we're going to be serving the Lord during that particular time. So, and I believe it's for that 1,000 years, a literal 1,000 years. And there are some that would say that it's not literal, but the Bible says it's 1,000 years. And I take what God's word says.
Absolutely. And I think people are really in a lot of trouble when you try to start metaphorically speaking in the book of Revelation. All of a sudden, nothing means anything. In fact, if you can do that to Revelation, I have found they can do it to the rest of the Bible as well. And so this is what's so important. When people try to metaphorically explain Revelation away, the very name of the book, the Revelation, or the unveiling of Jesus Christ, this is who Jesus is. So if you take away the unveiled Jesus and call it a metaphor. No wonder the Bible in Revelation 22 says God will add to you the plagues of this book. When the Bible says that if you take the mark, you will never go to heaven. I don't care what minister with what kind of PhD letters behind his name, how world famous he is. When he says, oh, you can take the mark of the beast and still be forgiven and go to heaven, that is not what the Bible says. Well, any sin will be forgiven. No, when the Bible makes an exclusion, it makes an exclusion. If you take the mark, you go to hell. That's why I tell people, if you don't want to receive Jesus as your Savior, you think you're going to somehow be clever enough to make it through the tribulation period, don't take the mark. And when I hear people do this, sometimes well-meaning Christian ministers say kooky stuff like this, I have to wonder what other kooky things have they endorsed. My dad always said this, rarely will you ever find anybody that errs in Scripture in just one place. When the spirit of error is working, you'll find it works in many areas as well. I believe that. And so understanding that, when the Bible is clear about these things. Now, I want to go back to our third caller and basically say this. Before the tribulation happens, though, we want to understand that Jesus takes his church out. The Bible clearly says his bride is not appointed to his wrath. And I believe that the church is removed. But when that is, I don't know. But all Jesus said is watch and be ready. When any man comes along, Jesus cannot come back till the middle of the tribulation. Don't listen to him. They're lying. Jesus isn't coming back at all. It's just the second coming. Don't listen to him. Jesus, the rapture is at the end of the tribulation. Don't listen to him. There's something wrong. Again, the rest of the Bible does the commentary on the book of Revelation. It's not hard, friends, to understand. You have to be taught wrong to twist Scripture. And when somebody comes along as an example and they say, well, the mark of the beast isn't really a mark. It's worshiping on Sunday. Read Revelation 22 and find out what's going to happen to these people who, calling themselves a prophet or a prophetess, change the word of God so that people could actually take the mark of the beast, believing what this false prophet says, damn their soul to hell forever. But because they listen to a false prophet, believing that the mark of the beast is worshiping on Sunday, rather than what the Bible says, a real mark on your hand or on your forehead, you won't be able to buy or sell, conduct commerce. That's what the Bible says. So we have to be extremely careful. Revelation, the unveiling of who Jesus Christ is. Any last thoughts, John?
No, I would agree with that. You know, I'm looking forward to that millennial reign. I'm looking forward to hearing that trumpet and being called up to be with the Lord. And I want to be watching. I want to be ready when he says it's time to go. Man, this is, let's get it. Let's go for it.
Let's go. Amen. Okay. Well, Randy, I hope that answers it for you.
Yeah, they did. Yeah, and I just want to make one last comment. Yeah, we gotta. I know I'm ready to go, but all the Christians out there listening right now, we make sure you're truly in Jesus, because there's a lot of scriptures. John 10:27 says, "Jesus knows my sheep hear my voice, and I know them,
that's right,
and they follow me." That's another good mm-hmm. one. See, that's saying right
Amen.
There, the true Christians, and the end is near. Out there, everybody, and the true Christians, God knows who they truly are. Those are the ones that are going to go in the rapture.
Yeah, well, that's what the Bible says. Jesus said, watch and be ready. You don't know what hour Lord is going to come. If it doesn't make any difference, then Jesus was lying to the church. Oh, it doesn't matter how you live. Once you're a Christian, you're going in the rapture. That isn't what Jesus taught. Otherwise, why would he say, I'm coming as a thief? Watch and be ready. You don't know what hour your Lord's going to come. If it doesn't make any difference, then why did Jesus say that? And these are the problems that we run into. So important, remember, God loves us. He loves you too much to share you with the world. Any last thoughts, John?
Well, I think it's been a great program today, Mike, and a lot of great questions, a lot of end times questions, and it's just a joy to be able to talk to people who study the Bible and have a heart for the Word of God, and I hope that we're making a difference.
Amen. Robin, Will, and William, please call us. We'll put you on first thing tomorrow. No waiting. Promise, promise. And we'll get that taken care of. Randy, stay in line. Send you out some books, some DVDs. Thanks again, John, for being with us. God bless you.
Ministry, or to receive a copy of today's program, please call 1-800-357-4226. Or write us to Every Man an Answer, P.O. Box 391, Twin Falls, Idaho, 83303. That toll-free number is 1-800-357-4226. Subscribe to the free podcast on iTunes by searching for To Every Man an Answer in the iTunes store, or visit us online at csnradio.com/TEMA. To Every Man an Answer is a production of CSN International, the Christian Satellite Network. The opinions expressed by our guests may or may not be those of CSN International or of this station.